I just like to see it, right? What is this? This is our weapon. This is our sword, right? This is what we fight our battles with, right? This is it right here. This is every answer that we need for life and godliness according to 2 Peter 1:3. And so we want to make sure that we are equipped as the body of Christ when we go out and we compel people to come in and let them know what God has done for you. You know, your greatest witnessing tool, you know what your greatest witnessing tool is? Your testimony.
That's right.
What has God done for you?
Amen. Amen.
And so, anyway, I just encourage you to come out. But anyway, you got your Bibles, and let's start. And God has put on my heart today, ever so often, as a body, we need to talk about the vision and the mission of Word of Life. Amen?
Amen.
And so why do we do that? We do that so we'll all be on the same page. Because some have come in, some have been with us for a long time, and some have not been with us as long, but we want to talk about the vision of Word of Life. And if you turn in your Bibles, Proverbs 29:18, it says, where there is no vision, the people perish. So what does that mean? In my vernacular, it means you got to have a plan, right? You got to have a plan. You got to have a short-term plan, and you have to have a long-term plan. And we have both. We have a plan, and we are on the plan that God wants us to be on. I want to share with you the mission and vision of Word of Life. But first, I want to just kind of dissect some terms that we use. Because I think we kind of take these terms for granted, and I want to examine what the word church means. Because there seems to be a whole lot of people out there that use it incorrectly. And so Webster's, it defines church as Christians, regarded as a spiritual entity. It also can be a building for Christian worship, a congregation, a religious service, our Christian denomination. And Strong's Exhaustive Bible, it says in the New King James Version that the church is the ecclesia. That's Greek for church. And so the church is an assembly of Christians who gather to worship, and we're worshiping Jesus. Amen? And so a company of Christians. Finally, the church is described as a whole body of Christians scattered throughout earth and heaven. So the church is made up of Christians. So now I'm going to ask you, what is a Christian? Strong's defines the Greek as Christianos. A Christian is a follower of Jesus, a follower of Christ. Any followers of Christ?
Yes, amen.
You know, we are followers of Jesus. So what does it take to be a follower of Jesus? What did Jesus prescribe? In Matthew 16:24, Mark 8:34, and Luke 9:23, Jesus was talking to people, and he said to them, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And so, as Paul said, many times we have to die daily to our flesh, take up our cross and follow Jesus. What does that mean? That means that when we decided to follow Jesus, how many decided to follow
Jesus?
Thank you. We became a disciple of Christ. We chose to live by his ordinance, by his commandments, by his words that are found right here in the scripture. Amen? We made that decision. And so I know that I'm breaking it down today because I just feel like that God wants us to think about our choices and think about what we have committed to do. In John, Jesus also told us in John 14:15 that if we love him, we'll keep his commandments.
Right.
Amen?
That's right.
And so if we love God, then we're going to do what he says. And Matthew 22:36-40, one of the Pharisees, a lawyer, asked Jesus the following question. He said, Master, what is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus said, if you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, first and greatest commandment. And the second is like this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. So on these two commandments hang all the law and prophets. So as a church, say it with me, we are the church.
We are the church.
Say it again, I am the church.
I am the church.
We are the church, right?
The church.
And so as the church, we're a body of believers that adhere to the word of God and follow Jesus. So we are disciples. Amen? What is a disciple? A disciple is a follower that follows the disciplines of Jesus. So as constant attendants of Christ, we're called disciples. All Christians are disciples of Jesus because we profess to learn and receive his doctrine and his precepts. So we are disciples, we follow the disciplines of Jesus, and we belong to the church.
That's right.
So here's where I want to shake it up a little bit. The church isn't just something we do on Sunday.
That's right.
It should be our identity. It's who we are. It's what we're made of because we're disciples of Jesus. Now, as our body, our church is Word of Life, and we have a mission and we have a vision. And so I just want to talk a little bit about the mission and vision today. What is it? So we're all on the same page. The definition of the word vision is the act or power of seeing. And the definition does not differentiate on what type of seeing. In fact, if you study the word, you'll find the vision is more or less what you see in the spirit. So what do you see in your spirit? Sometimes when we're distracted, sometimes when we're not focused on the word, sometimes when there's a lot going on in our lives, we're not really led by our spirit, but we're led by what we think, what we see, what we feel, and what we hear. But what does the word say about that? The word says we should be what? Led by our spirit. Amen?
Amen.
And so our spirit should be talking louder than our mind, talking louder than what we see, louder than what we feel or hear, louder than our circumstances. Amen?
Amen.
And to be a Christian means you are, God talks to us. How does God talk to us? God is a spirit. We are spirits. He talks to us how? Spirit to spirit. And if God talks to us spirit to spirit, wouldn't we want to be led by our spirit? Amen?
Yes.
Because that's the voice of the Holy Spirit leading us, right?
That's right.
It is somewhat frustrating sometimes when I hear people say, something told me to do this, this, and this. Or something told me not to go down that road.
Right.
Or something told me I should do this. Listen, it's not something.
It's not something.
It's God. It's the Holy Spirit.
Someone.
Your spirit is connected to his spirit. And he,
right.
Psalm 119, 105, he does what? He shines a light on your path. Amen?
Yeah.
So he shines a light on your path. You're not wondering. You're not wavering. You're not tossed to and fro. You're led by the Spirit of God.
Amen.
If you listen,
yes,
to the Spirit that's on the inside of you. Now, let me tell you something. The Spirit is always, always, always going to line up with this.
That's right.
Right here. It's never going to go against the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
So if you are feeling like God is telling you to do something, it's going to be backed up in the Word. Amen?
Right.
Amen. And so, you know, God shines a light on our path if we'll listen to the Spirit. Now, I want to tell you something. Sometimes when God directs you to do certain things, it makes no sense. I'm just going to let you sit on that for a second. It makes absolutely no sense. The people around you say, why are you doing what you do? Why are you doing that? I'm listening to God. Well, don't you think God would have me listen? Come on now. God has a right to interrupt our lives. And sometimes it's different and unique what he tells us to do. But you know what? I've learned a long time ago to trust The Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Why? Because the Holy Spirit knows. So look at your neighbor and say, trust the Holy Spirit.
Trust the Holy Spirit.
Am I right?
That's right.
Yes. He'll ask you to do some crazy stuff. Amen. He'll ask you to go places that you don't want to go. He'll ask you to be bold and say stuff that you don't want to say. He'll push you out of your comfort zone in a way you've never been pushed before. Why? Because he has a purpose, he has a plan, and he has an assignment for your life.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I believe that. So we follow the Spirit as Christians. We listen to the voice of God. That is our identity. Now, the definition of the word vision is the act of power and seeing, and what do you see in your spirit? The problem with a lot of Christians is they don't necessarily see anything in their spirit. You don't want to live like that. That is very low-level living. You want to live an exciting life? You want to see God do things in your life? Then start praying in the Spirit and call those things that aren't as though they are and push the envelope and do what the Scripture says. Amen?
Amen.
Then you're going to live a powerful, exciting, adventurous life. But no fear. A life of no fear, but a life of faith. Pushing forward.
Right.
Pushing back the enemy. Taking the kingdom away from the kingdom of darkness and expanding the kingdom of God. Amen?
Right.
That's what God has called us to do while we're here on this earth. It's not that we don't get saved. I'm just going to say it. Y'all care if I talk plain today. We don't just get saved to sit on the couch and eat ice cream and watch TV and wait for every day to go by till we get so old that there's nothing left for us and we go into an old folks home and wait till we go on to be with Jesus. That's not how I'm going to live my life. That's not how God wants for your life. He wants you to what? Be live long and live strong and push back the darkness as the army of God.
Amen.
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 But it requires something of you.
Right.
We cannot take the path of least resistance.
Right. That's right.
No, we have to take responsibility and do what God has called us to do. And I want to be faithful to my assignment, don't you?
Yes.
Faithful to your assignment with your time here on earth, because there's people who are counting on you to share the gospel with them. Amen. Amen. They're counting on you. Look at your neighbor and say, they're counting on me. And so what do you see in your spirit? You know, we got to live, you know, some people live day to day in the natural without ever tapping into the supernatural way of living that God has provided for us. And if you live that way, you're only in the physical, only in the natural.
That's right.
You'll never have a vision for anything. And one of the issues in church is getting everyone to see the vision. If you don't spend any time one-on-one in prayer with the Holy Spirit, you'll never see the vision. And so the mission of Word of Life is to reach the lost. That's our mission. Was to reach the lost and bring them into right relationship with God. And secondly, the second part of the mission is to empower believers to walk in the authority that God has given them. That's our mission. And I think we do a really good job. Could we do better? I'm sure we could. But, you know, that's our mission. To teach people to come into, to understand the word where they know that they have authority over any demonic attack. That's the mission. The vision of Word of Life is to reach the nations with the gospel of Jesus Christ, beginning with our families, our community, our city, our state, and our nation. And you know, I'm just going to say, a lot of people come to church to spend time with God, and God is here, and we have a time of worship. But church is also a time to learn, and it's also a time to put into practice, and it's also a time to ask God what He would have you do. Amen?
Amen.
Church is not necessary. If you, how many of you have been saved over 20 years? All right, you're deployed. Amen? It's not a time for you to sit. It's a time for you to do. Amen? How many of you have been saved over 10 years?
I have a save over 20. I have a save over 10.
Over 10 years? That's right. Okay. So you have gifts, and you have talents, and you have abilities, and you have experience, and you have things that will help the church here at Word of Life. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. And so you have to use your talents.
That's right.
And your gifts. But your assignment is your assignment. Your assignment is not my assignment.
That's right.
It's not up to me to go to you and tell you what your assignment is.
That's right.
It's up to you to pray and ask God what your assignment is so that you can fulfill it and you can fulfill it at Word of Life. Amen?
What your assignment is so that you can fulfill it.
That's my echo. Amen. Amen. So a lot of people come to church with God and God is here. But where we grow inside the church and we grow in the knowledge of who He is, but we also grow when we spend time with God every single day of our lives outside the church. And when you study and learn and get in the Word. And you know, sometimes what people do is they get so distracted. And instead of taking the time to be with God, they come to church and expect to be spoon-fed everything that they need for that week. I'm going to tell you, this isn't all of what you need. God isn't just our Sunday God. God is also our Monday God.
Amen.
Our Tuesday God. Our Wednesday God. Thursday, Friday, Saturday God. Amen?
Amen.
And so
Amen.
It's a relationship. What happens if you just talk to your spouse on Sunday? Hi, babe. How are you? How was your week? How are you doing? It seems like I haven't seen you for a long time. Oh, yeah. It's been a whole week. Well, what's going on in your life? Your spouse? You going to talk to your spouse that way? Amen? No. You talk to your spouse all the time, right? When we're separated, Chaplain Ross and I, when we're separated, we call each other 5 or 6 times a day. What are you doing? Texting? What are you doing? Why? Because we want to be connected even though we're separate physically. Amen?
Amen.
What about with God? What about our relationship with God? You just don't talk to Him on Sunday, put Him up on the shelf, and say, see you next week, God, and just go on about your week and go on about your daily life without including the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
And then you want to know why you don't hear from God. Amen? Yeah, you'll hear from God when you have a daily conversation with the one who talks to you, who knows you, who loves you in spite of everything you've ever done, in spite of your faults, in spite of everything that it is about you that needs growth. He loves you anyway. He wants to teach you. He wants to guide you. He wants to have a deep and intimate relationship with you. He's given everything so that He could.
Right.
He gave His one and only Son to defeat the darkness so that He could have a relationship with you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And so it's up to you what kind of relationship you're going to have with God. And I'm imploring you today, have an everyday relationship with the Holy Spirit where He walks with you and you talk together and you ask Him about, and you're led by your spirit now, not by your flesh. But if you never spend time with God, you're going to be led by the flesh. Amen? You're going to be led by what seems right to you instead of what the Holy Spirit is saying. Amen. And so study. Get into the Word. Get into spending time with God. Go to church. Expect God to move. When you come into this place every week, you've got to expect God to move. Amen. Got to expect that things are going to happen. That God is going to talk to you. That God is going to talk to your neighbor. So what is vision? It's the ability to see ahead, whether in the natural or the supernatural. Now, I can go outside and I can look north and I see the doors, but you know, I can see past these doors And I can see, I know it's across the street. 7-Eleven's across the street, because I've seen it. It's across the street, and on the other side of that is the 91 freeway. And I can shift my focus to the east, and I know if I travel on the 91 freeway and go on down to the 60 through Moreno Valley, I can envision my way to Texas, because I've been there so many times, just by looking east. I know we've driven it throughout the years, so I have a vision. I know that we have to go to Phoenix first, and then we go to Tucson, and then it's New Mexico, and then Las Cruces and El Paso, and then it's all across West Texas through Odessa and on down to DFW. But I don't really know what's on the other side of DFW because I don't really go that way. And although I know it's there, I haven't traveled that road as much as I have from here to DFW. So I really got a vision of it, right? And so if we've driven it enough throughout the years, and you may have a vision, and you may see, and you may know. But if I rely on a map, I know there's still towns. I know there's still cities there. I know there's other states that exist, even though I haven't seen them physically. And if you can't see something in your spirit, it won't manifest. Amen?
Right.
And so it's like looking at a map. You know it exists, but you haven't seen it physically. The spirit is our map. Amen? And if we'll look at our map, he will lead us and guide us and shine that light on the path.
Amen.
That we should go. Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the confidence of what we hope for, assurance about what we don't see. King James Version says faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things yet not seen. So faith is the substance. Say it with me. Faith is the substance.
Faith is the substance.
So that means it's made. Faith is made up of something. It's made up of our hope. It's made up of our expectation. And it's made up of our vision. I want to talk about Abraham for just a little bit. In Romans chapter 4, verse 17, it says, God tells him, I have made you a father of many nations. And it's our father in the sight of God in whom he believed, the God who gives life to the dead and calls into being things that were not. So against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and he became the father of many nations, like it was said to him. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead because he was about 100 years old. And that Sarah's womb was also dead because she was about 90 years old. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded, say that with me, fully persuaded that God had the power to do what he has promised.
Amen.
And that was why it was credited to him as righteousness. You know, Abraham had to have vision. He had to see himself as the father of many nations. And before it actually manifested, you have to see yourself in a position before it will actually be manifested. Today we're focusing on the vision of the church. And I want to ask you, do you have a vision for this church? Does your vision, now be honest with yourself, you don't have to answer out loud. Does your vision consist of only what the church can do for you? Or does your vision include what you can do for the church? Do you expect the church to stay the same state that it is today? I hope not. Or do you expect growth? You know, and it's interesting that people will say they want growth, but yet when we start to grow, they're uncomfortable in allowing new people to come in. Amen. Listen, we're not called to be a clique.
Amen.
We're not. We're called to be the church. And people are going to come in with different personalities, different opinions, different way of life, and we're still called to be the church.
Amen.
What is the church? What is made up of Christians? Who is a Christian? It's a disciple of Christ. What does that mean? That means grow. I want to tell you something else. When there's growth, there's life. And God is bringing His life, and there's compassion, and seeing people grow in the knowledge of who God is, and seeing their life change right in front of you, and understanding that this is what God has called the church to do, to bring people into a relationship with God so that they can grow and become stronger and stronger and be a disciple of
Christ.
Amen. Amen?
Yeah.
And so, we want to see people grow. With it comes extra responsibility. There's more work when growth is involved. Everyone must do their part. Growth brings life. It brings change. It brings new personalities. It's exciting. And it requires more from us. So what is the vision? Our vision is really part of our mission, is to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus. And another part of our vision is to see believers walk in the authority that God has given them. And so as Word of Life International, we're endeavoring to do just that. And it comes with a responsibility. To have that vision manifested, we must increase in every area. We got to increase in attendance. We got to increase in mission. We got to increase in every facet of the church. And did you know that increase is God's plan? Never once does God declare, and Chaplain Ross said it today, never once does God declare, I hope you decrease. Amen? He wants us to increase. But if we're short-sighted in our vision as the church, and we only think how the plan of God benefits us, we'll never see the increase. When you come to church, you can't be thinking, what can church do for me? If you've been a Christian for a while and a Christian for a time, you should be coming to church saying, God, what is my assignment today? What is it that you want me to accomplish while I'm at church? Well, number one, come in ready to praise and worship God. The saints come marching in, not the saints come dragging in. Right? We're the saints that come marching in. We hear the voice of God. We spend time with God this morning. He's given us our assignment for the day.
That's right.
God, what do you want me to do today? I'm going to tell you something. That should be your prayer every single day. Lord, what would you have me do? Amen?
Amen.
And then when He tells you, do it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And allow Him to lead you and allow Him to guide you. Are y'all receiving this?
Yes, day? Amen.
Great.
Amen. And so, what does your vision include for the church? What can you do for the church? Do you expect the church to stay the same or expect growth? And we want vision and have a vision, and our part of our vision is to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Listen, if we just reach people in Riverside, this church will be full.
Amen.
Amen?
Yeah.
So, if we're short-sighted in our vision as a church and only think about how the plan of God benefits us, we'll never increase, and we need to come to church thinking how we can be a blessing instead of just coming to be blessed. And I want to tell you, talk about something. I want to tell you something. When you're in pain, pray for someone who has pain. Amen? I want to tell you, no matter what you're going through, if you allow the Holy Spirit to use you, you know what happens when you're being used by God? Whatever it is that you're going through is being healed.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen?
Amen. So push yourself through. Allow the Holy Spirit to use you. And listen to the voice of the Spirit. Amen.
Yeah.
So how can you bless the person next to you? How can you bless the person in front of you? Instead of waiting for someone to come up and bless you, how can you be a blessing? What is the blessing? The blessing is an empowerment, the ability to empower someone else through prayer, through encouragement, through finances, through caring, through compassion. You know, one time on my birthday, somebody messaged me, and they were from Africa, and he sent me a Facebook message, and he said, Pastor Fred, it's your birthday today. I want you to know that I have been praying for you, and devoted my time of prayer for you for the last 24 hours. My gosh, what a blessing that somebody would be praying, would be interceding for me for 24 hours. That was a blessing. You see what I'm saying? We have the ability to bless each other. We have the ability to bless those that come in and will listen to the Spirit and not be thinking or distracted by everything that's going on in our lives. I'm going to tell you something about distractions. If you are constantly distracted, the devil will make sure you have distraction after distraction after distraction so that you will be rendered ineffective to the kingdom of God. Amen? So decide, I'm following Jesus. Whether the house stands, whether the house falls, I'm following Jesus. Whether something comes and blows it away, or a tornado comes, or an earthquake comes, or whatever comes, and I have nothing left, I'm following Jesus. Refuse to be distracted of the things, I'm not just the things of this world, but what is happening to you. Amen? And have peace. And let that peace of God, oh my gosh, that peace that passes all understanding. What do you think that peace is that passes all understanding? It keeps you focused. It keeps you from being distracted.
Right.
Amen? Because you're focused on Jesus and what he has for you. Praise God. And so, what do we do? As Word of Life, we're endeavoring to bring people into the knowledge of Jesus Christ. We want to be a blessing. Instead of waiting for someone to come up and bless you, how can you be a blessing? And so I want to ask you this morning to spend some time in prayer. We're going to have some time. You can kneel in your chair. You can come up here and kneel. Come up for prayer. Whatever it is that you want. You know, however it is you feel comfortable. But what I want you to do is spend time with God and ask God, how can you be a blessing?
Thank you.
Amen. Because we're growing. You hear me?
Yes.
Every chair in this place, I declare, is full of Jesus' name.
Amen.
And the people that are going to come in are going to have problems. They're going to have issues. They're not going to have their life together. They're coming because they're looking for answers. Right?
Right.
And we want them to come so that we can love them, so that we can bless them, so that we can empower them, and so that we can help them be the disciples of Christ that God wants them to be. In Jesus' name. Amen. And so, it's no longer, you know, lazy church. No longer lazy church. Right? It's the church that does something that works. That works and puts our faith into action so that we can grow and do what God has called us to do. And as you spend some time in prayer about the vision of the church, and your part in the vision, I want to ask you what your part is. What gifts and talents do you have? Are you committed? Do you tithe? I guarantee that you have a part. And I can guarantee that it's time you participate in the vision of Word of Life. So this is a time of change. We're believing God for our building and our growth. And I'm looking for a building as we speak. I'm still looking for a building. You should be praying in agreement with these two items. And as a disciple of Christ, our focus, our mission, our desire is to bring people to Jesus.
Amen.
The Great Commission, Matthew 28:18. I've given you all authority in heaven and earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey the commands I give you, and be sure of this, as I am with you always, even to the end of the age. And that is our mission, to make disciples out of people. Amen? And bring them to Jesus. That's our focus, that's our mission, that's our vision. That's what God has called us to do. Amen? And so, as the church, we need to be obedient to the commandments of what this book says. Go and make disciples. I'm going to tell you something. That's not just for preachers and pastors. That's for everybody to go and make disciples. And so it's time, church, that we rev up our engines, pray every single day that God brings somebody to you that you can talk to, and that you can bring them to the love of Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Y'all hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Amen. Let's stand. Let's go to the Lord.
Thank you.
Praise God. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I call their week. I pray, Lord God, that
it as your spirit goes with them, that you that favor and mercy and love and compassion, obedience, and all the fruit of the Spirit goes with them this week, God, as they go throughout their week. God, I pray they sense your presence in a powerful way each and every day of their lives. And God, as they come in next Sunday, that there will be a difference in that they spend time with you and they come in as an army of God, ready for duty, ready to do what you call them to do. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Love you guys. God bless you.